When we start Genshin, the first scene is the unknown god stopping us. We know nothing about who the twins are or who the sustainer of heavenly principles is. She only tells us the arrogation of mankind ends here, and you know what happens next. But why exactly did she stop us, and who is she? More importantly though, why did she send the twins back to Teyvat? Now, recently, not only have we found out that the Travelers are Descenders, a term the Fatui uses for individuals who are not from Teyvat, but also that the Heavenly Principles might be the first Descender. Even Enjo wanted to prove that Celestia was not from this world. But the twins being Descenders actually makes them a target for Celestia. Knowing what happened to the second who came, who has been mentioned across texts and in different stories, it seems like while the Heavenly Principles might be a descender, they are not exactly descender friendly. The reason this is relevant is because if the Travelers were in Celestia, or what we think is Celestia, at the beginning of the game, how does stopping their journey benefit the Heavenly Principles? If you're threatened by every other creature that comes from outside of Teyvat and you find them at your doorstep, why would you send them back? Now, I don't think it's simple to answer this question, because the motivations of Celestia are a big mystery. It's easy to write them off as the big bad evil in Teyvat, or a creator that has turned into a tyrant. But I think it's far more complicated than that. I'm sure you've heard this many times, but Genshin's system of Archon, Celestia, and the Primordial One seems to be inspired heavily from Gnosticism. Gnosticism talks about a demiurge who believes he is the true god but does not know that the real god is someone else. Interestingly, Genshin's Chinese title translates to original god. But I don't want to get into who the demiurge might be or whether that is what's happening in Celestia now. I want to focus on another facet of Gnosticism in relation to this. In Gnosticism, there is a feminine figure called Sophia. Her name is also synonymous with wisdom and knowledge. She is supposed to be an emanation of the light of God. You know what that sounds like? A shade. We know what that means in Genshin, but let's think about that a little bit later. It is believed in Gnosticism that Sophia somehow fell from grace. Some texts even say that she fell into the void away from light and the power of the true God, and that led to the creation of the world and the demiurge. She is also represented as the mother, whose fate is said to be the prototype for the lost souls that descend into the void. The void that she descended into is said to be separated from the celestial abode by a boundary, and the material things and the land of shadows and darkness exist within it. Now, this does sound like Teyvat, but is there an equivalent of Sophia in Genshin? Before we get into that, let's recall how Nahida preserved the Wanderer's memories in the 3.3 interlude quest. She saved the Tutarasuna incident in the form of an allegorical fairy tale, and the memories that were backed up in the Akasha, she hid them within this fairy tale. This opened up many possibilities, considering the mysterious books that exist in Teyvat have always seemed to have a deeper meaning. One such book piqued the interest of the Abyss at the beginning of the story, The Pale Princess and the Six Pygmies. This book hasn't been completely released until now, and I think it's for a good reason, because it might reveal too much if players go reading into it. Regardless, the first chapter of this book talks about a Night Mother who controlled the faraway land of night. No light touched this land and no trees grew there. The Night Mother is described as the source of all sin and the land was the embodiment of her evil. She disliked light and tried to avoid it at all costs. Now, this is a fairy tale, but the description of the Night Mother is of a powerful entity that is associated with sin and shadows and darkness. We could relate this to Sophia, but if we are to take the logic that Nahida used, the Night Mother should have to describe someone in Genshin. Even in allegory, this story could be a retelling of something that happened. The Abyss Mage that took the book said that it hid a secret that he didn't think that someone from Mondstadt would be interested in. I have a few ideas for who this Night Mother figure might be, but before that, there was more to read in the book. While all of it has not been released, the chapter summaries give you an idea about the Pale Princess, the Light Prince, and a prophecy. Now, I do not know what the prophecy is, but the Light Prince in a Kingdom of Night suggests that he might be from outside the world the story is set in, like a descender, if I may. The story tells us that the light prince and the pale princess meet the pygmies, but the pygmies have evil intentions, and eventually the night mother talks about some prophecy. I think because of the pygmies, something happens to the princess and the prince, and they might either be separated or hurt in some manner. The night mother in the story seems to be adamant to not let light into the kingdom, so she could also have hurt them. I can only speculate this, but based on what little we know, it doesn't seem unlikely. Although, this story also reminded me of another story with a certain someone from afar coming and meeting a Seelie and then disaster following it. It doesn't help that the Seelie race is also identified with their pale skin. But I digress. While the Night Mother's description slightly matches Sophia from Gnosticism, there is one more character that is called the sinner and source of evil, and that is Rhine Daughter or Gold. I know, it's absurd to suggest that Gold might be the creator of the world or the one that cursed the Seelies, but the reason I bring her up is because she isn't exactly human either. Gold was alive during the Cataclysm, and she's still believed to be alive. All her descriptions call her a sinner and someone who fell into temptation and ambition, but there is no mention of how she's still traversing through Teyvat after all these years, created life forms in the barren lands of Khandria, which did not have light or any living flora, just like the land of the night. But her lack of aging could have been a curse as well. We know that Dane is also the same, cursed with immortality, living way beyond the average human's lifespan. So yeah, even though the description fits, I don't think Rhine Daughter could be the Night Mother. In Gnosticism, it is also said that Sophia sits at the gates of the mighty, or the entrances to the upper realm of the light, which if you ask me, sounds very similar to 1, the loading screen of Genshin, and 2, the place that we met the Sustainer. But can this be the identity of the Sustainer? And if it is, what was the purpose of separating us from our sibling and stopping us from leaving Teyvat? Here's what I think. The character profile of the Traveler says, "The Keeper is fading away, the Creator has not yet come, but the world shall burn no more, for you shall ascend." Now the Keeper here could be referring to the Sustainer. If you remember the twins' encounter with the Sustainer, one of her arms seems to be affected by something. It looks like blocks moving within her skin. I don't know if this is her slowly fading away or if it's how her powers manifest itself. It could also be a symbol of her connection to the Abyss, but this can't be said for sure. Also, the creator that the profile speaks of is a creator that has not yet come, as if they're awaiting his arrival. I have a few elaborate thoughts about this, so let me explain. If you have been to the domains in Genshin, I'm sure you've seen the mural behind the Ermansol tree that gives you artifacts and other materials. There are 5 shapes on top of the mural, which many people believe are supposed to represent the 5 artifacts. Each set in Genshin has a flower, a feather, a timepiece, a goblet, and a circlet. You know what else these can represent? The primordial one and its 4 shades. Now we know of Ishtaroth, or the god of time, who's a shade of the primordial one, and Farnes, who is said to be a shade, but also could have been the primordial one himself. This does confuse me, because how can he be a shade and the primordial one when there are 5 shapes and 5 artifacts? The circlet of logos, which looks like a crown, could represent the primordial one. What if the one in Celestia is Farnes, believing that he's the true god of Teyvat, fitting with what the Demiurge would believe in Gnosticism? The drastic change in the attitude of the primordial one towards the unified civilization and the sad fate that the humans that existed during that time had to go through could be explained this way too. For Farnes is not the same god that loved all of humanity. I believe that the Sustainer is also a shade of the primordial one. As I said before, Sophia was also an emanation of the true god, and she sits at the gates of the entrance to the upper realm of light. But if the Sustainer is a shade, is she stopping the travelers to protect Celestia or Farnes, or did she send the twins back to Teyvat because she knows Farnes is not the primordial one? While Ishtaroth uses time to help the people of Teyvat, is she using her powers that literally displaced and transported the travelers back to Teyvat to change the fate of this world? I know it does sound like a bit of a reach, and there is a very good chance that none of this is true, but These were my thoughts and speculations regarding the sustainer of heavenly principles. If you watched until the end, thank you so much. Let me know what you think in the comments below. What are your theories for who's ruling Celestia, the primordial one, and the shades and the descenders and the countless terms that Hoyoverse hasn't completely explained yet? I will see you in the next video, and a very happy new year.